you have the following. So you have the couplings of the fermions to the pseudoscalar, and the two scalar Higgses are related. So there's always, even in more general two Higgs doublet models, you will have these sums. However, the sums on the right-hand side will have a different dependence on tangents beta. In other words, if you measure the couplings to, let's say, the heavy Higgs and the light Higgs to top, then you know the coupling to the pseudoscalar to the top. Okay. Now, the other thing I'll be using is that the low energy Higgs theorems for the multiple Higgses now changes a little bit. Why? Well, remember how we use this. So you take a certain process and you want to relate it to a process where you spit off an extra Higgs. And the way we used it is that there was the masses of the fermions which are running in there are coming from the electric symmetry breaking. So the masses are coming from the wave of the Higgs. But now the wave of the Higgs points in a different direction than the mass eigenstate, the lowest mass eigenstate, the small h. Right? So the direction of the wave no longer coincides with the mass eigenstate of the Higgs. So there's going to be only a linear combination which is in the direction of the wave, and these coefficients in this linear combination are different for, let's say, MSSM. If you have a top or a B couplings, these coefficients are slightly different. So the low energy theorem is a little bit more complicated now because you need to plug in these extra coefficients. Okay, so now let's go back to MSSM. We did the two Higgs doublet model. Now go back to the MSSM and see what we can learn about the MSSM. Now here, the structure of the theory is more rigid because of supersymmetry. So if we look at the scalar spectrum at tree level, this is it's a long formula here. Okay, you have a small h and a capital H. At the tree level, there's a relation between what? The pseudoscalar mass, the z coupling, and the tangents beta. Now the difference from just the two Higgs doublet model is that now the mass of this A governs the mixing. So if you're in the decoupling limit, the pseudoscalar mass also goes to infinity. So that's one statement you should remember, is that in the decoupling limit now the pseudoscalar mass will go to infinity. And the other statement is that if you look at this formula, stare at it a little bit, you see that there's an upper bound on the lighter Higgs. Right? There's the minus sign here. Now if you take pseudoscalar mass to be heavy, you can expand this, and you see that you end up with something which is mz if this is zero. In other words, there's a three-level bound on the Higgs mass, and it's the following. The Higgs mass, the lighter Higgs, is smaller than mz times the cosine of 2 beta, so this is smaller than 1. Therefore, no matter what you do at three level, the Higgs should be lighter than a z. Okay. Now, this sounds like a disaster. It's a disaster, right? The Higgs mass is 125 GeV, but the z mass is 90 GeV. So 125 is more than 90 GeV, so something is wrong, no? It's a disaster. Now, okay, there's loop contributions, of course. That was three level. If you also look at the radiative corrections to the Higgs mass, there's going to be an extra contribution. Now let's look at how big this is. So on the left-hand side, we have the 125 GeV. Now this thing can be at most the Z mass. That means that the radiative corrections have to be 86 GeV squared. You see that the three-level contribution and the radiative contribution are of the same size. So the loop contribution has to be very large. And the largest radiative contribution will come from the stop loop. So you'll have a top contribution and then the stop contribution to the Higgs mass. Okay. So in order to To work out the expression for this radiative correction, let's first look at the mass matrices. Why I'm doing this is because we'll be able to use the masses for the low energy theorems then. Okay? So first thing is that they mix because there are these eight terms in the Susi breaking eight terms, also because of the Susi conserving contributions. So the mass matrix which relates the two states, remember there are the left and the right stops. There's terms which are on the diagonal coming from supersymmetry breaking. There are terms which are on the off diagonal which have contributions from both the supersymmetric and the supersymmetric and the Susi breaking terms. And then there's also V squared suppressed terms which are not writing down, which also have Susi conserving contributions. So in other words, this mass matrix is a 2x2 matrix. And in principle, all these entries are non-zero. So the way you will get the mass eigenstates is there's going to be some rotation between the left-right basis and the mass basis. So the stop contribution, the radiative correction in the decoupling limit now has the following four. There is the log of the ratio of the stop masses with the top mass. And then there's also the mixing term. Now, what you can do in order to increase the mass of the Higgs is you can either have very large stop masses, or you could also have large mixing. You see that if XT, which is the mixing, is large, then this piece can also be large. Now, the maximum you can have is that this XT, the mixing term, is a square root of 6 times the stop mass. And that's exactly what you would see, is that if you have the mixing term which is 0, the mass of the Higgs as a function of the stop mass, the lightest one, is this line. Now this was done by two different codes, suspect and fine Higgs, which treat slightly differently the two-loop contributions, but if you take the mixing to be maximum for smaller stop masses, you get closer to the observed value. So maximum mixing, the 125 GV Higgs, you get for smaller stop masses. So you need large mixings. Another way of looking at this is that if you plot the regions where you get the Higgs masses, again from these two computer codes, the blue one is fine Higgs, suspect in red. In terms of the stop mass parameter, as a function of this mixing, you see that it's all sort of order one mixing, where the stops are the lightest. Now what's plotted here is also fine-tuning. The fine-tuning means how much you need to fine-tune the parameters in the Lagrangian in order to sit in this parameter point. So the larger the number, the more you're reintroducing the fine-tuning. Okay. Just to recapitulate, so what Higgs data are telling us is it prefers the decoupling limit, MA much bigger than MC. The Higgs mass prefers large tons in beta corner. Why? Well, because you want to maximize this cosine to beta. And it also prefers large stop mixing, because then the fine tuning is smaller. Right? So large tons in beta, large stop mixing. Now you see that we're already driven in a particular corner of a parameter space. So there's going to be definite correlations between Higgs productions and decays.
Sir, how large is the two-loop contribution? The one loop is so big.
Yeah, it's significant.
So the two-loop, how large would that be?
You can just go back to these errors, okay? Okay, so you see that it even matters what you're neglecting in this two-loop.
How large are they, sir?
So you should look at the lines are the estimated errors, the theory errors, and then the stakeholders are treated.
So
it looks like water.
There is a lot of uncertainty.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Yes.
So is there really trustworthy any of these analyses?
Well, I mean, your guess is as good as mine, no? Because the only thing we have is the perturbative preparation.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay.
All
right. Well, I mean, so this the quantitative picture might change, but the qualitative will not. No? I mean, this dependence on the parameters is really just how you break the symmetry. No? Okay, so let's look at this in a little bit more detail. The Higgs two gluons, so what we want to understand is, so what I want to convey is that there is a more rigid structure now of how the Higgs couplings would behave. So if you look, this, the aim of this next few slides is that if you sit in a talk where you have an MSSM practitioner which is doing scans and they flash one figure after the other and you're completely blown away because you have no idea where the correlations are coming from, then you try to remember what I told you here. So there is some structure there, and it's relatively easy to understand where it comes from. Okay? So it will require a little bit of algebra still, but not too much, because all the ingredients are there already. Okay? So the first thing we'll look is the glue to Higgs. Now in standard model, it's coming from the top, running in the loop. Now if you have stop and bottom, this will be the main contributions in MSSM, they also run in the loop, so they modify this glue to Higgs coupling. Now what we'll introduce is the deviation from the standard model, which we'll call kappa, and this kappa g will have contributions from the stop and the bottom, and the rest will be much, much smaller, right? So if the stop and the bottom are heavy, so much heavier than the Higgs, now we can use the low energy Higgs theorems to get the leading expressions for RH. Right? So we'll use low energy Higgs theorems to obtain these contributions kappa. Okay? Now okay, so let's think about how this will work. So the way you get to the Higgs coupling, so we want to have Higgs to glue, while we want to relate this to a process where we don't spit out the Higgs, so that we'll have only glue, and then this the loop from the extra particles. Well, this is nothing else but the contribution to the alpha S running. So the way we'll get the Higgs to glue is by looking at the threshold corrections to the alpha S running. So if you cross the threshold, there is going to be a contribution to the effective Lagrangian, and the coefficients here are really just the beta functions for the alpha S running. There's a log dependence on the mass scale, and it's a Higgs dependent mass. There is going to be a Higgs dependence for the stop mass, a Higgs dependence for the bottom mass. And the coefficient, as I said, is really just a sort of the beta function in the proper normalization. So this the first one will be 2/3 for our Dirac fermion, and it's 1/6 for our complex scalar. The way we get to the Higgs interactions to glue is now through the low energy theorems. So we Taylor expand the log times the determinant of the m squared. Right? So that was the expression I had before for the low energy theorem. So you take the mass matrix. From the mass matrix, we already can deduce what the Higgs to glue coupling will be. All right, so let's do that. So let's take our mass matrix. We had these diagonal terms. Now explicitly I took out also the v squared piece, which has the empty dependence, and the rest I can neglect, and then there's the mixing term, where there's also a mass term. So this mass depends on the web, and the low energy theorem tells me that I have to Taylor expand. Now, the Taylor expansion in the Higgs is the same in this case as Taylor expanding in the top. You take the log of the determinant of this mass matrix and you arrive at this form.
Right.
Now this form has two pieces. There's a 1 over m squared here, but then there's also the mixing term. Right? Now we say that we want to have large mixing. So large mixing would mean that this term is big. So this term will be big, means that if you are close to this large stop mixing, the kappa stop is the contribution to the glue to Higgs. So this total contribution will now be negative. So it will be 1 minus something. So typically you would find the suppression for the cross section of Higgs, the glue to Higgs. Okay. Now if you look at the scanning papers, that's exactly what you observe. So the Higgs to glue coupling divided by the standard model coupling is smaller than 1 generically. So in most of the parameter space, these are different. The way this was done, the hashed regions are scans over parameter space with certain parameters fixed. Okay? So this is the parameter scanner, the blue regions, as a function of the stop mass, and you see that it's typically smaller than 1. Now let's look at the Higgs to the stop contribution, this bottom, it's the same story, right? The mass matrix will look very similar, but there is an NB squared suppression, so the only term which has any hope of being large is the mixing term, if you take this mixing term to be extremely large. In other words, both from stop and bottom contribution, they cancel against the standard model top, and you would see the reduction of the glue to Higgs the cross section. Also decouples as 1 over m squared. So if you take the squared masses to be large, all these contributions will decouple. Now for Higgs to gamma, remember, we had a negative interference between the top and the W. Now we're saying that this stop contributions, the MSSM contributions are opposite to the top. So the top is opposite to the W, the stop is opposite to the top, therefore the stop has the same sign as the W contribution. So that carries over to the Higgs to gamma, so you have positive interference with the W. And it also, you can have stars running in the loop. So stars only contribute to Higgs to gamma. They do not couple to the gluons. Therefore, you will not reduce the glue to Higgs, but you will enhance the Higgs to diphoton. Now the deviations to the couplings to the WW and ZZ are smaller, typically because they scale as 1 over MA. The fourth. So that's what I just said. The Higgs to gamma, you can enhance by having a star light. So here, the star was taken to be 90 GeV, I think. 90 and 1 is around 100. Okay, so summing up the Higgs in the MSSM. So there's preference for the coupling limit, there are quite correlated effects for Higgs couplings. They quickly decouple for heavy particles, so it's either 1 over m squared, or in some cases 1 over ma to the fourth. You can have large effects, but you need very light particles, and a common example done by many people used to enhance the Higgs to gamma is the light tau, and light really means 100 GeV. Okay, so before I conclude, since I was really, really only focusing on the Higgs couplings, but there's an enormous effort, both by experiments and the phrenology community, on obtaining or discovering supersymmetry, there are many other searches. I don't want to convey a wrong impression. So there's many other probes of these MSSM particles. Like you can have direct searches at colliders, flavor changing neutral currents like beta is gamma, mu to e gamma, EDMs. Now, if we just look at the first lines of direct searches in colliders, and I only take one experiment, it already looks like this. So it's obvious why I had to skip this. There's a lot of phenomenology here. These are different different finite states, different topologies, and here is the mass scale that you're probing, so this is 1.2 TeV. First thing you note is that you are looking at the TeV scales, and also that there's many different constraints. Okay, so let me conclude. We've looked at the Higgs phenomenology in two extensions of the standard model. Now, the first one was the statement that the Higgs data exclude perturbative standard model with four generations or more. The coupling limit with large stop mixing of heavy stop masses are preferred in the MSSM. Now, in the afternoon, we'll have a third lecture where I look at the composite Higgs and a more exotic Higgs couplings. Thank you.
Questions? Comments?
So SN4 is ruled out completely.
Yes.
However, you can allow the vector like fourth generation, right?
Yeah, but that's not the sequential fourth generation.
Mm-hmm. Also, the other comment is in the MSSM, you allow the muton in Higgs 6.
Right.
Then you don't really solve the hierarchical problem.
Yeah, okay. So I have three more slides on NN and MSSM.
Yes.
But they're in the backup. I had to cut it out. So yes, there is a, as you correctly pointed out, there is a, I swept under the rug a problem that I really reintroduced, the Harkin problem, because there is a dimension-full parameter, which is the mu term, as you said, and the mu term is dimension-full. It sits in the superpotential, and the question is, why is this so much smaller than the other scales in the problem.
So will you talk more in the afternoon?
I will go on to the composite Higgs. So if there's the condensed version is in the backup, so there's three slides.
Other questions? Comments?
For large mixing, large XT, can you have a stop lighter than 200 GeV? Because I saw papers exploring the light stop, like natural SUSY or something.
Right, okay. There's another topic which is very hot and I didn't have time to go into. So the question is how light the stop can be. Right? Now, the story changed a little bit between when this natural SUSY spectrum was introduced and now. Now it's more constrained. However, there are still, it all depends on how much of the missing energy you have. So if you're very close to the top, this is a very hard region. So if the stop is almost degenerate with the stop, or the stop difference to the LSP is close to the top, these are the regions which are very hard to exclude. Now, the experiments and the theories, they came up with very clever ideas on how you can try to exclude light stops. So light stops meaning around 300, 400 GeV. And so if you look at the exclusions, there was really great progress in searching for these natural scenarios. So it's more constrained than it used to be, but it's still alive. There's still parameters, regions with which are alive.
Also, when you allow path parity or emission, and the stop is lighter than the, I don't know. The
So path parity violation is a very interesting direction. So the way most of the supersymmetric searches are working is that you assume that you have an exact R parity. The exact R parity gives you the stability of this dark matter candidate, the lightest supersymmetric particle. So you would have the final decay in the decay chain will contain an invisible particle which escapes the detector, therefore you have missing energy. Now, if you violate R parity, you would not have this signature, and you can avoid some of the bounds. So different searches will apply for R parity violating scenarios. Now, the problem with R parity violation in principle is that you don't know which of these R parity violating couplings are the dominant ones. So you have a richer structure, therefore it's a little bit more complex. So there are ideas on which ones would be bigger or smaller. And again, there has been progress made by the experiments to close the loopholes in the searches. So again, many of the searches were improved. I guess it takes time to close all the loopholes and discover something.
Do you have any more questions? Okay.
Yeah, I'll try one. What you've said is based on the idea that we need to solve the hierarchy. What if I say, I don't care about the hierarchy problem, that it just happens that at the Planck scale, everything's arranged so that things exactly cancel, and now all we have is, we have the standard model running couplings and stuff up to the very large scale, and there's no supersymmetry, there's nothing, except from the large scale, I guess we need some dark matter. Is there any kind of experimental or astrophysical reason why I shouldn't believe that?
It's an extremely good objection, no? Because the problem is the following. If you think about why we were so confident that we discover something like a Higgs at the LHC, it's because otherwise unitarity would be violated. Now, unitarity is something which is very, very hard to. It's a technical thing, it's really a structure of the theory, no? It's I sum up all the probabilities, they end up to one, no? It's something which is really, really hard to give up, no? Now, this hierarchy problem is different, no? Because technically there's nothing wrong with the standard model being the theory which is valid up to the Planck scale, right? There's nothing wrong. Talk about the stability of the vacuum, but even the vacuum seems to be just metastable, so it's stable enough that you don't have cosmological problems, right? You don't have a problem of why the universe is 14 billion years old. Now, it's really more of the fact that it's really a question whether this naturalness principle is a good guidance or not, is a very good question, no? So either you take it seriously, and then it gives you guidance at what and where these extended sectors should be, or you say that, okay, it's not a good guidance, there's this very, very big problem, which is the cosmological constant problem. It has the same fine-tuning problem as a much, much bigger one. You just give up now in that sense. It's hard to defend it at a very, very rigid level. No? It is a principle. We've seen this sort of expectation that you should not have very large cancellations sort of works. Now, if you look back at what we know, like the QED has cures the problem of the classical electrodynamics, that you have an infinite self-energy of the electron from just the classical electromagnetic field. So usually this